Okay, and to ask three declarations of interest. Members, if you've got any declarations of interest, can you let me know now? Can you answer?
It's just a letter of renewals. I was nominated to the Assembly by Cambridge University. I haven't worked for Cambridge University, and I'm required to represent the interests of Cambridge University, but in the interests of transparency, I was asked to make that nomination process.
Thank you very much. Dr. John Wells.
Likewise, I'd like to make clear that I was nominated to join the Assembly by the University, but not to represent the University, to be a voice for the biomedical campus primary. Secondly, I'd like to declare that I am a resident of Hardwick, which I think may relate to the portrait discussion. And as a third declaration, I am an employee of the University. I'm not involved in decisions concerning land use in the west of Cambridge, but in order to avoid any risk of there being a perception of undue influence, I propose to leave the meeting with the Chair's permission prior to agenda item on agenda item A.
Okay, thank you very much for making that clear, Dr. Wells. Councillor Richardson.
Thank you. As of Monday night, I was voted in as Vice Chair of the only portrait in 3 years of the meeting.
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Any other questions of interest? Vice Chair.
Yes, Chair. Could I just ask, Antony, can you possibly sit back where the press desk is so that you're not too close and interfering with Councillor Sitter and Member Sitter there? Thank you very much.
Okay, that's a good point. And not a declaration of interest, but a procedural item. Thank you, Antony, for that. And obviously, we will use microphones, but we will be able to hear. Thank you. Okay, agenda item 4 is questions by members of the public. As all the questions today relate to agenda item 8.4.2.8, I'm going to leave them until that actual agenda item has been given at the beginning. Likewise with the LLF and their recommendations. Any petitions today? No petitions today, agenda item 5. Okay, at this rate, if we didn't have agenda item 8, we'd do very well, I think. Agenda item 6, City Guild Forward Plan, 10.
Which includes workshops to get the community involved in scheme design is that consultation will not now proceed on the 1st of November as originally planned and originally agreed in the June report, but actually will take place in the first half of 2017 when there's been a chance to incorporate community feedback and get a good detailed result of design that reflects what's around those workshops.
Okay, thank you. Any questions on that at all, Ms?
Can I ask a question about the city centre capacity improvements and the sort of seeking the views of the public businesses, etc. Obviously, everyone was in, that is affected potentially by those improvements. And I'm just wondering, are there any direct approaches to particular employers who are affected, or is it a sort of general political management consultation?
There have been huge numbers of consultation events, including events at particular employers, particularly larger employers in the city centre and those who are members of the Travel for Cambridge partnership, as well as exhibitions, evenings, afternoons for residents, members of the public in Greater Cambridge. And the team has been engaged in very, very attentive programme of engagement activity, particularly this month.
Yes,
I think Anglia Ruskin is probably one of those larger employers, and I'm not quite sure, or rather I infer from the question that I'm being asked that we haven't had a specific
I came and sent it to Anglia Ruskin University staff a few weeks ago. I can check the exact date if you'd like, but I had a good conversation with a group of staff.
Well, maybe continue at the outside the meeting if you want further details on that. Thank you. Any other questions at all on agenda items? Okay. Now I'm just going to make a note. 4:10 we get to agenda item 8. We'll see when we finish agenda item 8. So what we're going to do, could officers give us a very, very brief introduction to agenda item 8, then I will ask questions from members of the public and responses, and then the chair of the voting and responses, and then officers, if you could give a more detailed introduction, and then I'll open up to members of the assembly. And Dr. Wells, thank you very much for coming in. Okay, Ms. Minnies, would it be yourself? Okay, could you make it very brief, sort of a couple of minutes, no more, just for this particular? Thank you. Well, you've got to leave something for later when I ask you to stand.
This is a very, very short presentation.
Can you go into the mic, because, sorry, can't hear.
This is a very short presentation, only a handful of slides. Just to briefly say, we're on the process for conference, and this is override recommendation. I hope you're all very familiar with the transport vision, as the slide shows.
Come here.
This is very much setting the vision for the city deal for the transport vision, and it shows where the scheme fits in the context of that.
I think, Mays, could you just bring your microphone a little bit nearer? Is that better at the back?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
I think it's important just to go back to why we're here, why we're doing this, what the point of this whole city deal is. And it is very much linked to the local plan, the long-term transport plan, the transport strategy. It's about what we're going to do for the next 15, 20, 30 years in the Greater Cambridge area. Not just what the situation is now, but that long-term thinking about how the growth is going to work, how it's going to be sustainable, how it's going to be in the area between employment and jobs and housing, and all the other things we need to do. I think it's useful just to keep that in mind, focusing into quite detailed aspects of the project, like this, we are doing this for the long term. I'm sure you're familiar with the problem we face on this particular route into Cambridge, the delays on Langley Hill after coming into Cambridge, the flow off the M11, combined with that flow, and around Langley Park and Ryde site, the and that the extent of queuing on there. Also the seal of development. Sorry, we did edit this down with a short presentation. I'm usually glad we've got the longer one on the screen.
I was wondering, I just wanted to show that to start with and then slightly longer one back on.
If you've got more ammunition later on, that's great, but
could you sum up as quickly as possible?
Apologies, my enthusiasm for this option. So, as I say, we recommend this to the review, it is the one that actually meets the policies of the three councils and the objectives set in the city deal, and most meets those, and will most serve the long-term needs of the community living in this corridor. Thank you, Chair.
No, thank you very much. Thank you for setting the scene. So, I'm now going to bring in the public questions that we've heard from earlier in the agenda. We have five questions today. The first one is Dr. Hansen. Welcome, Dr. Hansen. Today, because there's only five questions, I'm going to allow the full 3 minutes. And obviously, do you wear the traffic light system? When it goes to Andy, you basically have 30 seconds left, and when it goes to bed, you start getting me annoyed. So please try and keep it to the 3 minutes. Okay, thank you very much.
Well, I'm quite important to mind you.
That's great, thank you.
So I'm talking here on behalf of every colleague partner on the Cambridge Fund Medical Campus. So we're largely positive about the fact that you are beginning to tackle the problem of how to get the commute into central Cambridge improved from Cambon, and because we will in our view provide at least partially a solution for the wider context of how we get people to the campus. At the moment there's about 1,000 staff that will be affected by it, that use that route. But looking ahead from late 2017 and certainly throughout 2018, it will become even more relevant for us as AstraZeneca and Public Hospital becoming operational. And what we would like to do is to encourage staff from the first day to use public transport, and that's only working if there's a credible, attractive option for them available right from the beginning. That said, there are two queries that we have that we've put forward that are in the papers, but I'm going to reiterate them again. One is the wider context, how this improvement of the A428 revenue growth corridor will be embedded in the wider link towards the Southern Fringe, which we are positioned in the current planning. And the second one is what happens before 2024, because we really need a solution by 2018 when we're really reaching the peak of the increase of traffic from the western part around Cambridge, and how the tranche one plans are really enable our staff to get along that corridor to the CBC, to the campus by bus.
Okay, thank you very much. I didn't have any bias with the time there. I'll answer that one. Well, okay, thank you. No, please stay there, that's fine. I won't bring you back in at all. I think it's polite for you to be there for what this is actually addressed. Thank you.
Obviously, this falls upon as part of the wider city deal plans to create a network of high quality public transport.
Could you speak into the microphone? Thank you.
This proposal forms part of the wider city of plans to create a network of high quality public transport, secondary pedestrian throughout the city and beyond, making key as housing deployment, obviously CBC is really important in that respect. So in terms of housing development, other projects, there's city centre access proposals that we discussed earlier that come out to engage with the public, which we aim to start implementing possibly as early as next year. And there's a Western Oracle proposal which has been developed, which is part of the tranche 2 proposals, and that's expected to combine to create, with the proposal that we're here today, to create a sustainable route from Cambon and the other places in this part of Cambridgeshire to CBC. The challenge of how that's delivered by October 27, clearly the time scales for really the infrastructure schemes simply won't allow us to actually mobilise these things as quickly as that. So I would recognise that and say that we are pushing forward these things as quickly as we reasonably can.
Okay, can I ask on the back of that, how people can keep updated as to what's going on, because not everyone knows this. So the question is quite a wide question there, and it's a pretty general answer, which is fine. But obviously people need to keep up to speed with things.
It is a challenge for people. Not everyone reads fashion documents and new things. and follows what is going on. The key place to get information is through the city website, which has all the different projects on it, and all different aspects of the city, not just the transport schemes on there, and has regular updates on what's happening with progress on schemes, with public consultations, and as schemes develop and reach the next stage, and sets the programme for different schemes in there as well. There's a lot of information on there.
Okay, thank you. Tammy, you wanted to add something?
Yes, there's a recently launched City Deals e-newsletter, and I'll send sort of half of the link so that you can sign up if that's of interest, and that will encourage everybody who is not signed up to sign up and to give us some feedback on what's good and any other ideas for keeping people
informed. So actually endorse the newsletter, it's a good newsletter, so that'd be a good idea. Plus harm, thank you very much. The second public question is from Stephen Curtis. Stephen, welcome.
I represent Save the Westfields. I want to talk about the catchment area. And I'm not saying by talking about catchment area that we agree with the scheme, because we disagree with the total scheme. Nevertheless, we would like to encourage you guys to push the board to narrow the catchment area of option 3A to exclude the Westfields south of the Coton footpath, thereby safeguarding the Coton corridor right away to Grange Road. We would like you to remove from it Grange Fold completely, the land either side of the Binbrook owned by Jesus College, and we also would like the route alignment to be taken through the West Cambridge site along Charles Babbage Road, which would allow a route that then would skirt or go north of the Coton Orchard, and thereby preserve the setting of Coton, and then ultimately we would like you to move the Park and Ride location away from Avenue Morch to a less harmful location, maybe option 2 rather than option 3. Site 2 rather than site 3, or maybe further afield. I'm not going to talk at length because you've got my question there, but there are really sort of two simple issues. The first issue is community. No one wants the catchment area you propose. Thousands of people oppose it. I'm very simple about this. If a route can be found that people are ultimately find acceptable, surely it's smart to back the community's judgment. The second thing is, frankly, the issue of judicial review. The High Court clearly stated that the Coton Corridor was the most important location on the edge of Cambridge. It's hugely sensitive. You know, there's stuff about, anyone who says to me that ploughing a 21-metre road, including etc., and putting a vast park and ride is somehow going back to the landscape, beggars belief. So there we are, that's my question, and I'm sure other people will raise similar issues.
Okay, you're more than welcome to sit there here or wait for the answer. I'd just like to say that I attended the Fourth Way Canada the other night, as I know Councillor Vick did, obviously Councillor Vick Smith did, and the Vice Chair. It was very well attended, and you know, you are listening to it as well, so just so that you know, you know, the LLFs were set up so that we actually could hear what the community was saying, and I appreciate you coming on today and actually emphasising as well what was said there. So, who's going to answer? Is this Smith, isn't it? Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I think made a point on side to make earlier. We've actually set the catchment area quite wide. We've done that normally. We've done that because, as part of the next stage of work, we get to the point of actually identify routes or routes and not be sure that we consider all reasonable routes. We don't get hard information, that's part of the next stage of work as to what the particular environmental issues may be along within that catchment area. There may be issues that what might see an obvious route on the ground is not an obvious route in practice when we find some particular flora and fauna, for example, or some environmental consideration. So we need to be able to show and actually get to the final route that we have reasonably considered all options. And so we very strongly urge you not to use the catchment area at this stage. That will come further down the line in the next stage of work. We've actually got information in front of you that says in detail what the pros and cons are of the different routes. I would also like to make it clear that we have not ruled out taking the route through West Cambridge. Clearly, there are issues there about that the segregation can be achieved. That's part of an ongoing discussion with the developer there as to what can be achieved. We can't rule that out. What we do think is important at this stage, and all these different things are still up in the air, is what to be done, but we don't reduce the size of the catchment area at this stage. I'll leave it
there. Alright, thank you. Stephen, I'm sure your concerns will be discussed at this assembly meeting this afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Lonnie, welcome. The usual procedure, but 3 minutes this time. So when you're ready, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our question relates specifically to the location of Park and Ride, the selection of the site of Crown V, which we think is probably one of the worst possible sites that could be chosen. Reasons why you set out in the question is visibility, and it will be a huge degradation of an extremely important and prominent landscape feature in southwest Cambridge. It appears that the selection, according to the technical option analysis in paragraph 139 of this site, was made purely on transport planning and engineering criteria, with very little, if any, consideration given to the landscape and environmental damage it would cause. If you do proceed with this, I think that the city deal will quite likely be accused of environmental vandalism, and we would urge you not to commit such a significant folly. We point out that the whole scheme, including the park and ride, must comply with the principles of sustainable development as defined in the National Planning Policy Framework, which at the moment manifestly does not, at least with regard to the park and ride. So we would ask the City Deal Assembly to recommend to its executive board that it should reconsider all possible sites for the park and ride, including around Scotland Farm, giving this time they're giving equal status to the social and environmental considerations as to the access and planning criteria. I have just noticed, having come into the hall, Amendment 2 in the recommendations, which goes partway towards this. It's encouraging, particularly the last sentence in the meanwhile holding other options, including Scotland Farm, under review. What we were questioning is, what does under review mean? I think there should be the same assessment given in terms of the social and environmental considerations as there is to Cranby.
Okay, thank you for that. As far as the amendments are concerned, obviously the Assembly will be discussing them. But as far as your question is concerned, I'll ask for response from officers at this moment in time. Mr. Minnies?
Again, yes. There are environmental issues around the consideration of all the potential parking road sites. So it would appear that we've chosen recommend this site, but this is purely strategic transport issues. That's essentially because of our view was the environmental issues balance each other out. So, for example, sites too sufficient to trip their site. So, if you want to say environmental issues, all the potential sites, so therefore we recommend the site that actually there's most direct access to the proposal of the bus
one. Alright, thank you. Robert, can I ask a personal question as well, something that was asked of me? And I'm very pleased that you come along and you make your representations at the time. But you do say that you represent Cambridge PPF. I'm just wondering how many times Cambridge PPF met, because we have these meetings very frequently. I'm just wondering what remit or endorsement you have from Cambridge PPF, or whether you're actually doing it from yourself as a member of Cambridge PPF.
That's a reasonable question. I'm speaking on behalf of the Planning Committee of Cambridge PPF, which meets monthly, where we have already agreed a position, particularly not only on the route, on the proposed southern route, but on the objection to the park and ride. We meet again on Monday next week, where we're going to look at the route. So I'm actually speaking on behalf of the charity, not in a personal capacity.
That's explain this. Thank you very much for that clarity. Thank you again for your question today. Question four is from Councillor Bob Henshaw. Councillor Bob. You have 3 minutes on your bed.
Thank you, Chair. I'm here this afternoon representing Newham residents and also other city residents who are deeply concerned about proposals for the A428 corridor scheme that this Assembly is considering. My question is, how can the Assembly support this officer recommendation to move forward with this option when it clearly fails the City Deal's own criteria? As I'm sure members are aware by reading this report, on a value for money basis, it fails. It scores 0.2. When the City Deal building is 2. On an environmental and social distributional basis, it fails. Environmental impact score is 11 out of 40, the worst. On a deliverability basis, it fails. The deliverability risk is the highest, and the public consultation undertaken shows that it was the most opposed scheme, with over 65% of the just over 2,000 people who responded opposing the scheme. The only criteria on which it does meet is in relation to the City Deal objectives. So it fails 3 out of 4 objectives. And I believe the decision by the Assembly this afternoon to support the officer's recommendation would be an irrational decision. This is particularly the case in relation to the Coastal Corridor and the Westfield section of the scheme. Local plans from both Cambridge and South Kent place at their heart the preservation and protection of key elements of the Greenbelt, such as the Coastal Corridor and Westfields. This scheme, if approved, will put at risk, material risk, the position of those plans, as it will enable, by building a bus route across this Greenbelt, it will remove a key reason for preventing developers from developing in this area. So I ask you this afternoon not to make an irrational decision, but to recommend that other options should be explored, and that a decision on any scheme should be postponed until full funding for Phase 1 and Phase 2 has been secured, and also that other transport measures that are being introduced by the City Deal can be assessed for their effectiveness.
Okay, thank you, Councillor. I think you've raised some points there that will probably come up in discussion with the Assembly as well. Mr. Menes, is it yourself again?
Yes, this is. I'm sure this will find discussion. The critical point here is this is the scheme that best meets the City Deal objectives. Yes, it's expensive, yes, it has environmental impact, but it is the scheme that best meets the City Deal objectives. And that's the basic truth. We have made a recommendation. Other schemes do not come close to meeting the City Deal objectives, we have to come up for a second. I also think it's important to come back to this point about planning and planning policy on whether this is a Trojan horse for further development. The NPP there, the National Policy Planning Framework is very clear that transport infrastructure, properly considered, can be built in the Greenbelt where other developments cannot. I would again make the point that it doesn't, we're talking about a ground level scheme in terms of its impact on the Greenbelt and setting Cambridge, and you will not be able to see this from a distance away. I would also make the point that it isn't set up the land. In that, yeah, if I want existing bus routes, you will see there are lots of formal and informal crossing points, so if for example, this is an archer at the lakes, the Grand Speedy Lakes, people cross the bus in all sorts of different places, not just formal crossing points. So in terms of service effect, that doesn't occur on it. It's a low profile in terms of its impact on the landscape and doesn't create Trojan horse for future development.
Okay, thank you. Sandy, did you want to come in and add some?
It may be helpful to the Joint Assembly to reference the assurance framework agreed between City Deal and the Department of Transport, which says that BCLs of less than 2 can be funded if there is a compelling case for investment, and those circumstances could include where a scheme is required to unlock barriers to growth, deliver wider economic benefits, environmental, social, distributional impacts. Also worth noting that the assurance framework states that the executive board will make decisions on which schemes to prioritise based on a high-level assessment of contribution to objectives, value for money and deliverability. So it's a range of criteria as set out in the report. And the strategic objectives or particularly evidence confirmed by contribution to objectives is important in this context. Whilst it's more quantitative in the way that the BCR is.
Okay, thank you for that. You might need to be reading them out again later. Thank you, Councillor. The fifth and last question today comes from Dr. Basil Fox and then about me. Is it just yourself, Dr. Fox? Okay. Dr. Fox, when you're ready. That's it.
Thank you. My name is Gabriel Fox. I'm the Vice Chair of Coaten Parish Council. Our council. So we discovered a few days ago last week that the not only does the proposed option put a busway right through the village of Coaten, which could pass as close as 10 feet to the nearest houses, but also there's proposed new apartment rides, as big as the one in Trumpington, right next to Coaten, that will dominate our village day and night, and being on that large slope will not be possible to screen adequately. So I hardly need to say the extent of damage which our village and our community faces. If we thought this decision was rational, then it might be somewhat easier to swallow. But the proposed option, as we've already heard, is the most expensive, has the worst cost ratio benefit, the highest environmental damage score, wreaks the most social damage, and was by far the most opposed by local people in the consultation. And it would appear that this is all for a 2 minute improvement in journey time, for 2 minutes at best. We consider, as has just been said by Rob, that it's an irrational decision. It was made on the back of an unfair and improper consultation. And if the City Deal does decide to proceed with the option as it's currently set out, then we consider that we leave our parish council with no option but to seek legal advice on judicial avenues, such as judicial review, to oppose the scheme. Our question today is, why has there been so little effort to seek a solution that uses Manningley Rise? We've done extensive measures. We believe that the footprint is easily wide enough to accommodate any number of options, including a segregated busway within the actual road, a tidal scheme of a single lane, a scheme that puts the buses and cars on the road and routes a high-quality cycle park elsewhere, such as behind American Cemetery. We believe the current bridge can be used either as it is or with amendments. But if the City Deal really is desperate to waste £60 million of money, then buses could use Manningley Rise and then veer south just before the bridge and across the M11 due west of Charles Babbage Road. Any of these options would add a maximum of 2 minutes, possibly not even that, to the journey time, and could be realised at a fraction of the financial and environmental cost. So we ask that those options are properly investigated before a decision is taken to proceed further with option 3A. And we would add that we reject the suggestion that other options come up for a second, when the cost would be lower and the journey time would be negligibly different.
Appreciate that, and I appreciate you speaking up towards the end when you saw the end. Ms. Mendes.
Thank you, Chair. We have looked at the potential options on Whiteney Road, and we would disagree that there is room for extensive two-way bus train on there, parallel to the road, and that would take the carriageway right up to the fence line and possibly beyond it. Things like verges, not just there to look nice and actually hold the road up, the actual like visibility around bends, etc. When it comes to the junction at Colton Crossroads, you were probably talking about configuration, something like the junction hub at LCRC, on Orchard Park, complex traffic signals to make sure the buses and traffic can move parallel and can be controlled in and out. There are issues with the accesses. There are a number of houses along there, and access out. There are level differences. Some of those houses are level well below the road, who actually drops from the edge of the carriage into some of those. And in looking at a potential route that would take the route parallel down across M11 on a skew, that would be a very long bridge. competitive by the square of the length because of the structural nature of the stuff. A very much more extensive bridge. And we certainly take private gardens, possibly take a bungalow. So it has a significant environmental impact, a significant cost, and does less well in terms of the patronage and the journey times. So we recommend against that.
Can I ask a question from the chair here? If you were to take a cycle way out of the scheme, out of the equation, just how wide do you actually need the road to actually accommodate the road bus, the cars and buses?
I think the danger of taking the cyclist somewhere else is that not all the cyclists go somewhere else. And you then end up with cyclists on that route and on the cyclist cycleway.
I appreciate that, but that wasn't my question. So the answer is it's at a cycle way out 18 to 20 metres.
Including reasonable allowance for barriers. That's all on a straight section with no junctions.
No, on a non straight section.
You're then looking to be winding on the diverging event, and you've got poor visibility and several curves. You then you've got issues of access and visibility from accesses.
Just full time up till 20 to 22, what do you mean?
Depending on the geometry of that particular location.
Well, I'm just assuming that you've looked at it, so you've
probably. We have looked at bus lane options on here, we have not looked at the options before we've run out to the other end of a two way bus lane. It's a segregated two way. Possibly on the panel of the road. So we have a chance actually of any engineering designs on that, whereas our initial sets of looking at that model down already is we would have to go to those.
But have you not looked at it since Monday night, since you saw it coming up at the LLF, and probably knew that you'd have a question on it tonight?
We've not actually looked at a full engineering assessment.
I wasn't saying that, but just have a quick look at it.
We've had a quick look at it, and that's our assessment that we're looking at, that we would need to go outside the fence lines.
Right, thank you.
If you're driving back in there, probably we'll see the carriage drops rapidly into various properties.
No, I understand. Thank you. Dr. Foss, I hope I asked some questions that you would be asking as well. Okay, big question. Okay, I'm going to go on to Ben Bradley, the chair of the 4-8 LLF. It's been agreed beforehand that we will allow. We will try and allow 15 minutes for this, because obviously, as I say, some of us were the other night. You know, there's much discussion and debate. Helen, welcome. So we'll do our best between your questions, your resolutions, and officers' answers to, I'm not going to say get this, through this as quick as possible, but try and keep it to some sort of order of time. Okay. When you're ready, thank you. Right, you press the button and the lights come up. I'll tell you what, for this one, don't bother with that, I'll do my own time. Okay. But you need to speak into the microphone. That's it. Thank you.
I'm going to try not to repeat a lot of what has already been said, but that's going to be quite difficult because it was all from the same meeting. So I'm Helen Bradbury, chair of the A428LLF. Particularly evidence in the positioning of the preferred park and ride. environmentally damaging. Scoring worse for CO2 emissions, water environment, landscape and visible visual impact, and heritage impact. So the route plows straight through five National Trust government fields, a 100-year-old working orchard, Coating Countryside Reserve, and West Fields. And your summary document is highly misleading on this, we feel. And as Stephen Coates pointed out, we were reminded about the High Court judgment in 2008, which did place the coal coating corridor as the most sensitive of all locations identified to the western side of the city. And this proposal goes against the spirit of that, and I think would be open to challenge. So what are the benefits? Well, we've talked about 2 minutes improvement in journey time each way from Camberwell to Grange Road. And the wider economic benefit figure of £679 million, which is inexplicably £153 million more than other off-road segregated busways considered. And how can this be explained? And the problem is that many members believe it is because the university and certain colleges have quickly developed the coastal corridor, which would now be so damaged by the busway and the parking lot location. Anyway, the proposal fails on 3 out of 4 of your own criteria, and for these reasons, the LNF cannot support it in its current form. So what did the LNF resolve? Resolution 2, specifically about the third corridor, I'll just talk first. Resolution 2, so the LNF accepts the necessity for public transport corridor on the A428. There are serious reservations about option 3 and 3A on environmental and social, value for money and public consultation grounds. It asks the board to consider other options where the environmental and social impact criteria are given equal weight with economic benefits and marginally shortened journey times. As we shall see, the LNF would like the board to re-examine the route that uses Muddy Rise, and I will remind you later, Muddy Rise. Utilise the route through the West Cambridge site, not south of the footpath though, and the suggestion was made to look at it again at other options, and particularly option 4. So the catchment area, resolution 3. The LNF cannot support option 3-3A, while Westfield South area to the south of the footpath, the Coastal Countryside Reserve, and the area to the south of the Pole Hill Garden Centre are included in the catchment area. We ask for these areas to be taken out. Removing the Westfield site of the south of the footpath, and that's including Grange Farm, I guess we tend to imply that entry to Grange Road through Cranmer, Hirshall or Rugby would no longer be actually feasible. And one has to remember that entry to Adams Road would require in through a nature reserve. But actually, the entry to the Grange Road is not a self-carrying road. There is no part of the catchment shading between Bradley Long Roundabout and the M11 that the LNF can accept. The LNF wants the catchment area to be north of the coastal orchard. Now, how can this be achieved? Well, Resolution 6 was that the LNF believes there is sufficient width for a high-quality busway inside the facility to follow the road of the route of the existing road from the Bradley Long Roundabout to the M11 junction, and request that the board explore this option in more detail. There are several ways we think it could be achieved. The LNF supported a tidal route back in June, and believe this is still possible, as of course does Atkins. But a two-way way possibly we believe could be achieved on Madden Rise, especially if the high-quality cycle path were routed to the back of the American Centre. This route would either use the current most great cycle shoulders at it, that's probably saving about £50 million on a new bridge, so a lot you can do with that, and then turn right into the West Cambridge side. Alternatively, it could sweep down north of the coastal orchards and cross the LNF on a new bridge west of Charles Banks Road. It wouldn't necessarily have to be a long bridge, surely you could do a figure and come in due west. Anyway, then it would continue through the West Cambridge side on this route, through the new Cavendish development before ending up on Clark Maxwell Road. So, Carpen Rides. Resolution 8 was that the proposal to place the possible new Carpen Ride close to Manning and Marsh Roundabout is not acceptable. We support the new Carpen Ride site to be built at Scotland Farm Junction on the A428. we believe it will be used by more people actually, because you could go on there from there from the science park, for instance. Then it was passed with the addendum that if this is not possible, the LLF continues that Park and Ride Site 2 would be far less damaging, as it is the only one it could support. It's far less damaging because it doesn't come down a slope over either Coaching Village or Adderley Village. It would be on the top of the hill. You see, the preferred option is in an astonishingly insensitive location on a slope that drops 25 metres. And as Robin Flew said earlier, building a giant illuminated car park in such a prominent location would lead to accusations of environmental vandalism, and I think that's got to be true. Now, Resolution 5 dealt with the Girton interchange. And this resolution calls on the City Deal and Cambridgeshire County Council to release all documents related to their negotiations with Highways England. Were the Girton interchange reconfigured to allow access to the M11 South from the A428, one spur only, we're not talking all ways, one spur only, this alone would reduce traffic on that device by 20%. Because 20% of people come down there on a narrow road to turn right at the bridge onto the M11 South. So one spur. And then if then access to the M11 from Madingley Rise were removed, particularly if you'd be coming into the city, there would be room on that current junction of 13 Bridge for two car lanes, two bus lanes and a cycle lane. There would be no need for off-road at all and no need for a new bridge at all. And think about saving for that, so for one spur. And this is why I think it's so important. And if you built the Girton spur first, you would have a diversion during any work on Madingley Rise anyway. The MLF would like evidence that improvements to Girton are viewed as high priority, since all those living west of the city, including the coalition of the 23 parish councils closest to Cambridge West, all think this is by far the single most beneficial investment that could be made. One spur. Two more resolutions. Resolution 7 involved the perceived conflict of interest of the University of Cambridge. So we asked the University of Cambridge to remove itself from the board of the Cambridge City Deal for the Camborne to Cambridge busway decision only, to reduce the conflict of interest over its land development objectives. This was actually made stronger in the LLF, this proposed resolution, and the LLF is concerned that the University is both influencing group decision and promoting land development to the local inspector. Most members suspect that the university's response to the consultation, rejecting the north and central options, helped ensure that option 338 was preferred, and that if this is selected, the universities and colleges will find it easy to gain permission to develop greenbelt land between Barton Road and Madingley Road and north of Coton, from which it benefits on a huge scale. Finally, returning to Resolution 1. So the LLF asks the board to remove the whole of the A428 busway project from Phase 1 to Phase 2 in order to give sufficient time for a full assessment to be made of the success or otherwise of the current congestion tackling strategy, especially in relation to the points at which the busway would join the current road network. The addendum was that more research is needed on the benefits of the busway and how it will tie in with the Girton interchange and the Western Orbital route. Several members were keen, however, that we needed to do something quickly, citing ever worsening congestion and fears that delays would lead to the concrete failure of the local plan. However, the motion was passed, as most members want to see the congestion tackling results before thousands of tonnes of concrete are laid over significant green belt sites.
Okay, thank you. Not bad timing at all, so thank you for that. I'm going to go through each resolution in turn, and I'm going to do it in numerical order, not the order you did. But I think some voters have responded, but the majority actually probably don't want them to respond because we've had some sort of response and it will come out in discussion as well. So, resolution one, obviously, that will come out in discussion, so I'm not going to ask officers for a response for that. Resolution 2, we have had some sort of response already on that one. Resolution 3, I'd like to ask officers concerning Westfield's south of Footpath, Crescent Countryside Reserve, and the area south of Polar Garden Centre, what would be the consequences of taking them out of the catchment area? If you could ask that, please.
That does have a bit of discussion in it. Without evaluating all different route options within that catchment area, we can't draw a conclusion at this stage. We don't know what the best route is within this catchment area. We don't know the different environmental considerations, so we can't get what we want. So our advice would be, if again, that's preempting the next stage of the decision-making process, which would be when you have the different impacts, environmental, social, etc., impacts, the benefits, all the different routes in front of you. I don't know whether you can get a route through West Cambridge at 5 miles an hour or 50 miles an hour at this stage. You do the last up, and then that would be way up in the order. So if it's in the former, then it would be way down in the pecking order in terms of what we look at. So we can't at this stage actually draw any conclusions like that. What we are saying is we need to keep that area broad so we actually do that assessment, the different routes through that. Take those out to public consultation, you can see the evaluations we've made, you can make your own evaluations and your own comments, and then we bring those different options back. I think that's the point that we keep making, that these ideas of restricting that catchment area are preempting the next stage of the decision making process.
Alright, thank you for that. I'm sure the Assembly will come to its own conclusions then. Resolution 5, the Girton Spur, this keeps coming up on the basis of the ODF is asking for basically freedom of information, etc., which I have no problem with. I'm sure none of us have a problem with. But why has this not been considered as part of or even a standalone project to look at what the volume and reduction it could have and volume of traffic on the mountain road?
It's a long, long running issue. It was really about the 450 deal. When I was interested about then reviewed the 14 scheme post 2010, it was cancelled. They looked at the bits that gave value, the bits that didn't give value, and reduced the scope of government to change quite considerably, saving, as you recall, some 200 million from the price of the scheme. And they concluded at that point that there wasn't value providing those slip roads. From our perspective, it's the best partial solution because it creates new capacity. What happens when you create new capacity is you get more traffic. So whether it might take 20% off the traffic on Wagon Hill Road now, that space would very soon be filled up by other traffic. And you create new journeys, new trips around Cambridge as well, potentially going to other junctions on the island and creating more local traffic. So it's a bit of a second class, but it wouldn't be cheap. We're not talking about a new motorway slip road that would include a bridge, so it would not be a cheap thing. Well, we're happy to dig out all the correspondence we've had with them, I was in the rural areas, etc., and share that with you.
If you could make that correspondence available, I think that would be appreciated by the ODF to start with. I understand what you're saying about the cost of such a scheme, but when we're talking about the cost of all the schemes that we're looking at, it does seem sometimes to be quite a sensible one in amongst everything else that we're considering, and it seems to have been dismissed by the City Guild as part of the City Deal, and I would imagine it's close enough to be part of the City Deal and the catchment area that we keep looking at. So when did the City Deal actually look and dismiss the idea of the Girton Spur? I'm sure we have, but can you just remind me
a bit of that? We did at the very earliest piece of work, we looked at every possible option in this area. That would be when? 2 years ago?
Yes. When we first presented these items, we were given a number of scenarios from members to look at, and this was one of them. It was a very complex process that we went through to assess all of these configurations of junctions, bridges that would be in there, and also how we could in fact build that link. Because clearly what we don't want to do is to build something that we can avoid if we can build that extra capacity. And that was already assessed and looked at in some detail. I can't remember the exact date, but it was very early on in the assembly. The report was brought before this assembly, looking at those very options. I'm perfectly happy to look back and send those around to you, and covering those and also an indication of what conversations have been going on with the financing information, if that would help.
Okay, thank you, Tammy.
think it's worth also pointing out the strategy in the local transport plan, long-term transport plan, transport strategy for Cambridge and South Cambridshire is to support the local development plan, which is the Cambridge satellites, including Campbell, Bourne, Waterbeach and Waterstone, and in line with both planning policy and strategy to make sure more people living in those settlements are commuting, travelling into and around Cambridge by public transport, on foot and by bike, and doing the interchange rather than something that materially improves public transport between and cycling between Campbell and Cambridge would not align with those green objectives.
Alright, thank you for that, Tony. Resolution 6, we've already had a response on using the existing carriageway. It will come up again. Resolution 7, that's entirely up to board member and their own personal decisions to whether they should take part in discussions or not, declaring an interest, etc. But your point is well made and noted. Resolution 8 has already been responded to. Resolution 9, did you get that far? I can't remember Resolution 9.
No, I was writing stuff down.
No, that's fine, okay. So you're basically saying about the trial road closures, see the effect they have, etc., before actually doing anything else. I know what's this responsibility. It will take ages to work up something for the board to rate. Anyway, but I'll go to what this is for.
Very short one of the report, which sets out its own skills. We are at a very early stage still of developing this scheme, I think, because of the whole scheme. Probably the most crucial step will be the statutory approval stage, assuming we get that far, which will take place somewhere in 2018 and 2019, at which point we would expect the current programme to set peak congestion at 4 points to be implemented as well to all of this parking maybe. So well before the final decision point on this scheme, we will be implementing the community access strategy. I think that the two times that it takes to bring something like this forward, just simply stop now and then wait 3 or 4 years and you are looking back to 2030 in terms of delivery.
Right, thank you. We have done too bad on time, but Helen, our chair of the ALF, would you like to come back on one or two things here, or are you satisfied with the responses that have previously been given and the responses been given to those that I've just asked?
Particularly the Gerson interchange and the Muddingly lines, I'm not happy with the responses on. The Gerson interchange, if you look at the region, is the main intersection north, south, east, west, and the fact that actually it's not an always interchange is extremely surprising given the growth of the area. But the fact that you cannot get west onto the main road to your capital city, except by going down a very small, fairly narrow hill, and you have to wait in traffic to get there, is quite incredible, given it's not part of the scheme to change it. And the other thing, I think the other thing is that I failed to include in the report, is that Junction 13 Bridge is actually, it's suboptimal. And what we're proposing is to spend £141 million on a scheme that leaves a suboptimal bridge for 95% of the people using it. And I think the general public is pretty surprised about that. And going on to the Muddingly lines, then, I mean, we've done our own measurements, and there is a way that you could get, we believe, 2 bus lines, 2 car lines down there, and high quality cycle way elsewhere. And we applied and worked on, because I think, again, the public think that if at all possible, you should be using the infrastructure itself.
Okay, thank you. One question I have for officers. Is Highway Kingdom likely to look at the person interchange as part of the Oxford Cambridge link?
Yes.
Okay.
May I ask
yes,
you, in terms of the other point about the Muddingly lines, I suspect the best way to solve this is just for us to do some work. So rather than looking to a method of debate, I would suggest we do the way and not stop what we're doing on the proposed recommendation, but do further work. It costs the money to do a full topographical survey and some preliminary design work. And say, we believe it's not possible, but we, I think the best way to understand if you believe squat, it would be better to actually do some work.
Okay. And yourselves are going to do that work?
Well, we finished my question.
Without creating the response is what I'm trying to do here, and actually make sure that, you know, we get the figures out so people can understand is what I'm trying to do.
We'll commission a couple of applicants, right? We'll do some original design, initial design model, we'll commission our consultants to do it, we'll share it with all the players and problems we're doing it.
Yeah.
I think that's
a good way forward on that one.
Otherwise, we'll just be tracking back and forward. It will cost a bit of money to but I think probably that power will do their work.
I'd rather spend money than spend the hours debating it. So, debating whether we could look at it or not is what I mean. So, then I think there's been some positive on that, and the rest of your resolution certainly matters by this assembly. So, thank you to you and all your colleagues on the board spoke earlier. Councillor Bick, did you have a question for the chair of the LLF, or is this going into general? You are excused. Thank you. Officers, I was going to come to you for a more lengthy comment, but when I say 2 minutes, it becomes 7 minutes. So I'm not sure how long a lengthy one would be if I said that you've got a more lengthy introduction. Have you said most of what you need to say now?
And that's another overview, but I think that helps, yes.
Okay, no, I think that's probably right. Okay. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to open this up to Assembly members now. We've actually spent 1 minute minus of the hour actually getting to this point, so I think we've covered it quite well now. We, as Assembly members, can start our discussion on it. Councillor Bick.
Chair, I wanted to make one general point and then ask a question. The general point is that I listened to the public questions we've raised with this, and I think we all need to weigh what they have to say, very carefully as we go forward with this. But there is one point that I, for me, wasn't reflected. In sort of the blend of the opinions and observations that were made. And that is really to ask the question what we're here for. And it is in my book, we are here to enable homes to be built for people to live in, to do jobs in our local economy. That's what the city deal was brought into existence for. And the purpose of this scheme is very explicitly about connecting up communities, development of new communities in Campbell and the expansions in that corridor. I think it's also worth asking why those communities are where they are, because I think that is a very important aspect of our strategy. And I think the answer to the question why those communities, those new communities are where they are, is that we have a very strong supportive agreement around Cambridge, which has made it inappropriate to build those new homes, to work in the local economy, closer to the existing city where many of those jobs are. And so it seems to me that we start with the need to make joint decision making with the local plans that have been through in draft form, both planning councils, which enable these homes to be built, but will clearly face difficulties in having that plan stick if we don't help to make those communities sustainable and really great places to live for the people who we will need to live in. And my general point is that in the mix of your considerations, don't let's lose sight of this. The natural place in another world for these extra people, extra population to be, would probably be much closer to Cambridge. and we wouldn't be looking at this kind of scheme in the first place. But we, as a collective in the community, decided that we didn't want that for many good reasons. So we already start with a challenge at how to make these places really great places to live, to attract people who we need in our local economy. And I think that it has to be said that we need to do the very best we can, consistent with all the other objectives that people have highlighted in the questions, to make those places really great places to live. Because there aren't people already there to make those points. I think we have to remember it. I wanted to be part of the city deal. I wanted to start the city deal in the first place, because I think that it's about joined up decision making. And for me, this is exactly the point that we're sort of playing with when we look at the scheme. Now, I have many caveats, many differences, many spears that I would like to give to the to the transport plans about how this should go forward, and we may talk about those a bit later on. But I just feel it's very important we don't lose sight of the bigger issue here. If I could, having said that, just ask a question which may seem a bit detached from the general point. We talked a bit about the question of the economic case, the economic assessment for the recommendation that's been made in the alternatives. And I just wanted to get some more from officers on this point, because what I read in the papers is that the expectation is that we will be primarily guided at this stage by the strategic objectives that we want to satisfy, and that we will bring into play such things as the benefit-cost ratios and so forth at the next stage, when we're much closer to looking at precise alignments. What I think someone like me needs to know when I see those numbers is, why are some of those so low at the moment, and what is the realistic prospect of getting them significantly higher? I mean, I've told myself a story, because some of these corridors are quite wide at the moment and consist of probably many alternatives that haven't been found feasible, that probably we're looking at all the downsides of all of those possibilities. And so the figure ends up as very conservative. But that's a story I've told myself, because of course some of these benefit cost ratios are a long way away from where some people expect them to be. So I just want a bit more comfort that when one at a meeting like this sort of passes some scheme forward, that one isn't kind of eventually going to find that the benefit cost ratio that we end up with is as low as it looks now, and actually what actually moves to drive that to a more satisfactory level.
No, thank you for that. That's some very good points, and I think Tanya said something about VCRs earlier on. I mean, one thing I know about VCRs is obviously they could almost be exponential. It's not like if you double the volume of traffic, you double the VCR, it's a lot more than that. So I assume what you're assuming is that as more and more things come online and we have more facts, we can put it into the equation and it starts to go up. But I think it was a very valid point, which obviously would Mr. Menes.
I'll pick up on the call and want to go into closer detail with the plan on this. There are a number of factors. You mentioned the local plan. Under the rules for doing VCRs, so-called web tag, transport appraisal variance, the DfE said they take a very conservative view about growth. They've been bitten elsewhere or given more optimistic on growth. So you can only include what's in the local plan. So local plan, for example, I think on Wednesday has 1,000 houses at West Cameron. There's quite an application in to double that. We won't get 1,000 in the model. Not only won't get 1,000 in the model, we can only take the local plan period, which is 2031. Now the West Cambon on board will be built out in 2031. So again, only about half the houses are in there. So there's one factor. We will refine the modelling. We have a large model of the Cambridge sub-region. We are updating that at the moment. That update is not complete yet, so the modelling isn't done in the old model. And a
factor in that modelling is the number of trips from Camberwell to Cambridge. So that data will be updated in the new model. And Camberwell has grown considerably over the time period, that 10-year time period of that model, so that will be much revised. What is the actual trip factor, trip generation from Camberwell to Cambridge? We don't know the outcome of that yet. There are high expectations that it will rise. We haven't factored in the Cambridge access strategy, so that will be a deterrent if it's successful. People driving to Cambridge. The initial modelling actually suggests an increased traffic on Magdalene Road as people dive out. So again, that will push the VCR up. And you find that I'm absolutely right, it's a very broad brush cost estimate at the moment, with a lot of contingency and what's called optimism bias in it, which again is a DFT factor. They found the motors of schemes are over optimistic about cost prices, so the required level of optimism bias is it 40% for instance? 38% of the stages, I don't know what this is about. As you define the team, as you know what route you're taking, how big the bridges need to be, etc., and you also have to bring that optimism bias down, so that would tend to push the cost side down. We believe it may be that cost estimate is in the right order, we'll be more optimistic, but this stage would be meant to come down. So there's things that push the benefits up and bring the cost down. As often this scheme regards to the city project sharing development start to attract the issue.
I'd like to ask a question on that for clarity, please. You started up with the housing, and you're saying there's 1,000, but we're only taking 500 of them at the moment because there's another application for 1,000, but you can't include that. So actually, you're only including 500 out of 2,000 houses. Just so that we have an idea of exactly what you're talking about here with regards to the VCR. What difference would it make that VCR, those 2,000 houses, were built by 2031. You must have an idea of what effect it has to the VCR. Just so that we understand, because there's a lot of factors you were saying there.
Yeah.
Very,
very crudely and roughly, and there's a very low number we're talking about there. It might double. Is it still one? That's all one factor.
I hear the laughter, but I think it's important as we try and understand. You know, I guess it is one factor, but if it is, you know, doubling of 0.2 isn't the same as doubling 1. So at least we have an idea of what we're talking about now.
But clearly, if there are other factors
involved, I understand.
They all multiply each other. I don't think the challenge here is off the point of view of VCR 2, if I'm honest. I think we're also back to what the economic benefits and the strategic imperatives here of the council base outline in terms of. We expect it will come up.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Bridget Smith.
Thank you. Well, said early on that the option that's been put in front of us is in line with our local plan, but actually the South Camp's local plan is predicated on the need to preserve greenbelt, which is not what we're doing here, even though I appreciate that. We've done our utmost to build houses outside the greenbelt. And in our striving to create new places for people to live, I'm concerned that actually we're going to do irreparable damage to the great places where people are currently living. And we have a lot of people living with uncertainty and fear here, so I think we have to consider what we can do as an assembly to remove some of that uncertainty. And I think this broad brush approach we have by putting forward a very wide corridor which contravenes South Cam's local plan approach of protecting the greenbelt is actually the wrong one. So I think we need to think very carefully today about how we can limit the damage, and I will later on in the discussion propose an amendment to do that, because I think it's just not fair people that are living with this level of uncertainty, because it seems to me that we're having areas of land put forward which, you know, officers are implying actually don't stand to have health charts being approved. So why on earth are they staying in the process?
Okay, thank you. No question there. So, Councillor Pageant.
Thank you, Chair. I really probably won't cut a bit more to the chase on this. I'm an elected politician and it's my role to represent people. Part of representing
I've been looking at the ideas and the working out of options for further consideration, and I've been listening to what's been said. I've heard the argument about journey times, it will only take an extra 2 minutes, and I understand that journey times here are crucial. The important thing about journey time is not that it takes 2 more minutes, it's that it's predictable, that we can guarantee that you will arrive from Bolton in Cambridge in 28 or 30 minutes. Not that it might take 50 minutes or 100 minutes or 20 minutes. So the crucial thing here is the journey time has to be predictable. So I think that we should be looking at something that has a direct route in one way or another. I've listened to the arguments that have run in below. I think it's credible that Scotland Farm would make an alternative car park, an alternative park and ride. I think it's important, very important, to consider, if possible, avoiding the village of Carpen and the impact that we might have on that. I think it's therefore credible that we should be looking at not doing away with other options, but really working up something in line that goes north of Cambridge, north of this road, north of the American Center. I think it's important and credible that we consider a bridge over the M11. I think that whatever else we do to tinker with things, eventually that will need to be done. Right now we have the money to actually look at doing that. It's important to consider a route that goes through the West Cambridge site. And I think that finally, it's important for us to believe that we may well have to touch the edge of some ground and go down Baggage Road or something like that. But I think the important thing that I will be pressing for today is to look at something north for officers to have to work up, for us to recommend that officers work up something to the north of this area. Thank you.
No, thank you for that. For the chair, you know, I'm concerned about BCRs and whether they actually will get higher. We've heard an explanation of, you know, maybe they won't actually get higher at all. I'm concerned about the location of the parking ride that's being suggested by officers, because I hear what went on at the LLF the other night. And I find myself in agreement that it does seem like the wrong site to me. So maybe more work needs to be done on that. I hear what everyone says about the West Hills. I understand fully, and that's why I asked that question earlier to officers, you know, whether we actually needed to impose on the West Hills at all. The answer came back is they're trying to leave all the options open, but that doesn't mean to say that we can't recommend closing some options down. I haven't actually had anyone else that wishes to speak generally on this before we go to amendments. Is there anyone else that wishes to speak generally on this? Councillor Pitt.
Not to speak for a long time here, but just following through what Councillor Bajan was saying there, could the officers tell us how an extra bridge could be created in a different place from the southern position that it's proposing recommendation.
I'm one north
rather than not south?
Yes. No, I understand. I understand. Officers, I hope you understand too.
I hope I understand that. This was the option 4 that we looked at in terms of the report. The difficulty got is you're north of the American Cemetery. That has its own environmental landscape impacts. You'll be familiar with the standing rates and you can continue from there. I'm familiar with a very, very long argument with the shoutage over the impact of the bypassing the cathedral, which we went through in the end, but it's a very long time. That was a kilometre away from the cathedral, but affected the setting when you start affecting the setting of the particular heritage. That evidence is very, very, very difficult. So there's an environmental price to pay for that route. You can have all the bridge across the great. You've then got to come back south, either onto Magny Road or through the West Cambridge site. So you've got a lot of environmental disadvantages and significant time penalty. So you're not getting that direct route in from Cambon, but certainly you've spoken about, and you've got environmental impacts. Different ones, but they're still there.
Can I just come back because it wasn't completely.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Option four, as described here, does not include a bridge, an extra bridge. So I think that's kind of like the difficulty members may have had with responding to the options that are described on the file is that I think there is some feeling, I'm not sure whether I share it or not, that there should be somewhere in the frame of bridge north of the current bridge, but there is no option which includes that. So if there is no option which includes that, why not? And is that something that is worth our while talking about?
Obviously there's an option south, but there isn't an option north. And while you're answering that, could you also answer from the chair what discussions you've had with English Heritage about the option four and the American Central?
In terms of you're absolutely right, option four, we didn't curtail and tie into the existing bridge. That is essentially because by bridging over there, you then into the development sites, parking rights, so you can get anywhere. So you're building a bridge to not very much, you build on the north side. We have had discussions, we have had discussions both with the American Cemetery directly and the English Heritage. The English Heritage view this is very similar to the view on the bypass, whereas in the end we did go through that one. So one side.
So, have you had an answer to your bridge?
I'm sorry, I hope to, so I hope to shut up.
Officers, can you have an answer as to why the bridge was left off of the option four, and yet you can include it in other options, in a different position? Is there something about north that you can't do a bridge?
It's where the bridge takes you. It doesn't particularly take you up. You're into the park and right site, and then you're out. You've got the development that you've got around that park and right site. It doesn't add much at all to
it gives you the other side of the end again.
That's exactly but it just brings you back there, back onto the island.
Yeah, it gets you the other side of the end again.
It does, huh?
Yeah, I'll put it in there.
I thought that was before you, Councillor Fallon. No, it's not for us. It's Mike Marshall.
I'd like to have a good.
Could you let me speak closer to
that? Yeah. Thank you, sir. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
I'd be grateful to have an appreciation of how all this would change if we were able to have the link with the A14 at the Girton interchange. If that happened, then Highways Authority would be made to do that as part of the money they're now trying to spend anywhere building up local connections and so on. What difference would that make? Because it just might take the pressure off altogether and change the whole we're now talking about.
I appreciate that. I did investigate that as much as possible earlier, and it does seem to be more of a Highways England thing, and I'm sure we can never wait for Highways England because we shouldn't see it in our lifetime. Maybe. Who knows? We're not in charge of Highways England. So as much as I think it's a good idea and others do, it doesn't seem to be in our gift at this moment, but we can look at things and we're getting all the papers released, etc. So we look at it more as individuals and collectively. Okay? Councillor Patient, I am happy
to be here. Back to the officer. We're concerned, or the officers are concerned about the impact on the view from the American Cemetery. And yet they've explained to us that if you were 20 metres away from the route, then you wouldn't be able to see it until the bus came. Now the bus is not going to be continuous, it might be 10 an hour. So it won't be seen, because you will be more than 20 metres away from it when you're in the American Cemetery.
So that's meaning it's more the view from the American Cemetery. Is that right, officers?
Yeah. Clearly, yes, you look down the American, you look down out onto the fen from the American Cemetery. The way into this is the way you probably see it, right? You can see a long way. And that. One of our arguments that English Heritage brought here was it was actually quite hard to see the bypass from the top of the cathedral, but they were still concerned about it. We were looking down on it, down that slope, through the cemetery, so that would be a concern.
Okay. plan, so you can see the bypass from the conservatory. Still got it through though.
Yes, you asked for the general points, and I guess I wanted to give my kind of what are my underlying reasons that I'm trying to assess this case. And clearly, there aren't any easy solutions here. I keep coming back to what is the CPL meant to be about, which is about ensuring the future prosperity and growth of Cambridge. That's quite important. I do think we do need a segregated route in to give reliable journey times, as Councillor Bailey just said. I do think we need significant new capacity for the homes that are not yet built but will be built. And I do think we need something that's resilient and that in 30 years' time or 50 years' time will prove to have been a worthwhile project. And so it does seem to me that clearly we absolutely have to work as hard as we can to impact adversely on as few people as possible, but I don't think it's going to be possible to find a solution that does give us back to step change in capacity that doesn't have some adverse impacts. But going back to where I started from, I keep trying to come back to what is the city deal fundamentally meant to be about, and trying to make sure that in the end we kind of do things that will stand the test of time.
I agree, future proofing is so important, but for me it's enhancing the environment rather than damaging it, if at all possible. So that's where I come from as well. Chair Lassen.
Thank you, Chair. Can you hear?
Yes. Yeah.
So just to endorse a few of the logical points, I think the consistency of travel time is more important than saving a few minutes. Leaving 10 minutes on a form of transport with a laptop open is perfectly acceptable. If it's consistent, you can plan for that. I do sympathise with the use of existing infrastructure, and I do completely agree that we cannot have no impact at all with this. We've got buses travelling in and out one way or another. We need to support that and keeping the impact the same rather than significantly more beautiful than it is now. In addition to the bridge, we've got an existing bridge. It is surely more easy to build an extension. No, we need to ask the question though, so keeping an addition to the existing bridge would be logical. Yeah, that's fine. And taking a pathway through the West Cambridge site, expanding the path that is to the south of that through Trenton's Road and through from there to Queen's Road with some sort of one-way system with the traffic planning that we've got would seem to be perfectly logical and not a big negative impact. I'd work every day on that site, and taking buses at the back of that site would not be a problem as far as I can see. So just to endorse some of the logic and keep sympathy with some of the things that we should be doing.
Okay, thank you. Bridget Smith.
Thank you. Just to point out, the option three has the worst environmental impact score of all the options that we looked at. So it's very disingenuous then to use environmental impact as a reason for rejecting the other options. Because actually what we have in front of us is the worst one. So, you can't have it both ways. I'd like to agree that the time that buses arriving on time and getting to their destination on time is the main factor, far more important than actual journey time. I don't want to be standing at a bus stop waiting for a bus for 15 minutes in the rain. I want to know it will be there at 2 minutes to the hour, so I can arrive at 4 minutes to the hour and get on it. And as Claire said, quite happy to sit on the bus for longer, provided I believe I'm know that I'm going to arrive in time for my meetings or whatever. So I think the focus on the actual journey times is the wrong one. It's on reliability and predictability.
I agree, sorry. Reliability is what we've been told all the way along. Okay, so thank you for that. So Mark Marshall.
Do we know how many we're assuming the capital is all part of Cambridge? is it really? How many temple people actually go to London to St. Nicholas or through Huntington? So we've made that sort of assumption. And if Campbell goes on growing, would it go towards Cambridge or away from Cambridge? Have we got those percentages? The other thing is, when people come, or when people do come to Cambridge, which part of Cambridge are they coming to? The centre? They probably want to get out of sight, or the AstraZeneca, or one of these places. Not the centre. That's not. So we need some way around Cambridge, not in Cambridge.
I think there's some statistics on this, isn't there? How many people from Campbell travel into Cambridge and their destination?
Yes, we're just trying to find them.
I thought there was.
It hasn't been looked at.
The figures are available. I'm sure the officers will get the figures to you outside the meeting. Okay, I've got no one who wants to speak generally anymore. I think we've all made some points. We have some. Councillor Smith, coming to you. So, everyone's had general speak. We have had some amendments put in front of us. Councillor Smith, would you like to go through yours in whichever order you wish, but one at a time rather than all at once? That would be good. Thank you.
Fine, thank you very much. I'd like to take the second one first because that really relates to the discussions we've been having about the most desirable corridor. So I would like, so this refers on your papers to, let me get this right, 3A. On page 23, so we have 3A. So I would like to change that to so that it says, possible specific route alignments within catchment area 3A, this is the new bit, with catchment area 4 and a bridge to the north of the existing one as an alternative, noting that both may connect with and potentially through Cambridge West, and in doing so, seek an alignment which would exclude the land to the south of the Coton footpath but include the land to the north of the Garden Centre building.
Okay, thank you. So, do you want to explain what that last
worked up as well, but with the addition of the bridge to the north and
for, on page 23, recommendation 3, Roman numeral 3A. So it will become possible specific group alignments within catchment area of 3A and 4. With 4 including a bridge to the north of the current bridge.
Yes.
Noting that both would connect with and potentially, well no, they won't both, will they?
May.
So they may connect with and potentially through Cambridge West. And in doing so, seek an alignment which would exclude the land to the south of the coast and footpath and include the land to the north of the garden centre building. There's a proposal, an amendment on the table. Would you have a second on that? Thank you very much. Safety and anyone like to discuss that at all? Mr. Williams?
Just clarify what this is, the impact of taking a north bridge on potential west local routes.
So you mean financially or time-wise or the impact?
I've got the map in front of you, little else. So how, if you go to the north and enter somewhere in Matthew Park and Ride, how does that then connect with routes?
Well, I think that would have to be worked up.
You get an initial view.
Obviously, I'm just saying that, it's one of the things that would have to be worked out if we, well not we, but the board decides to ask officers to do it. Officers?
In terms of the rest of the whole, we would have to work that out, but there is no obvious way of doing that, that we can see from what we look at. If you go for a western orbital option, it's a separate bus on the road, then there's no link to that from north of. You'd have to come back, the best you could do would be come back onto Radley Road through West Cambridge and somewhere from there. It's not very satisfactory. Obviously, we're not clear, if we're trying to make sense of this, we're not clear what the cause of this in terms of the maps. So, for example, where does the bus go after it's gone through West Cambridge? So it comes back onto Radley Road. We're not clear on what's being proposed to.
So, I think what's been. This means that what's being proposed is that we're looking at option 4, whereas your option 4 wants to use the existing bridge, it's being proposed that we build a new bridge and then once you get the other side of the M11, you connect back down across the other side of Avenue Road again. I believe that's what's being suggested. With everything good and bad about it, that's what's being suggested at the moment. I hope that's clear.
I'm not sure I have to add to that. So this would be an option for the core, a new bridge, the park and ride side, and then a bus lane on that end of
it. I think that's something that needs to be worked out, like you said.
Well, there's no other route from West Cambridge. You exclude all the lands and stuff, we have all of the new park.
Okay, let me ask a question, officers. Can this be worked out, or is it impossible?
It's not impossible. It has cost and time implications.
That's absolutely fine. Thank you very much.
Just a quick question. Can I ask for a fact about where the Coton footpath ends? Because there's no reason at all not to go south of the West Cambridge site.
What is this?
So the Coton footpath, yes.
That is the southern boundary of West Cambridge site, yeah.
So that's all called the Coton footpath.
ratios, reduce the length of it, reduce the cost of it, you know, respect of it. mean, I don't know, I'm reading the papers, but that's what it's suggesting to me. So that I think would be good if it wasn't that page. I have some concerns about voting for the inclusion of an option that isn't on our papers, which is looking like 4 plus a bridge. Because I don't know how much that would cost, how long it would take to find out, or what the transport implications of it would be. So I have a bit of reluctance to assume that element of the amendment. And the other thing is that I think that people will find that if you exclude everything south of the Copeland footpath, then you will prevent any connection from the West Cambridge site to an off-road route into the city, because you're effectively the most northernmost connection on the Range Road by doing that, therefore have no way out. So, I mean, I think there's some problem I have with having some integrity about what we're voting for. I think there is, since it's too much detail on one part of it, and not enough detail on the other, it becomes a bit difficult to sort of people taking our role seriously and advising. You know, I have a problem with supporting it.
I understand. My job is to try and reach some consensus, and I didn't for 1 minute think I'd get that today. But it does seem to me that there's maybe 2 schools of thought here. Or maybe there's a school of thought for both, but we're looking at option 3A and option 4 with a bridge. And that seems to be what all the debate seems to be about at the moment. Would that have some sort of agreement with the Assembly at the moment that we would like those 2 options more work done on going forward or not? Because I'm trying to find a way forward. Councillor Lee, you're shaking your head, so please come in.
I'm shaking my head because I don't think the northern route has much to come in it. So, you know, option 3A, yes, fine. You know, there's some tweaks, but you know, let's talk about that. But I think option 4 is ruled out. I think it's paragraph 25 in the report. And I very much agree with those findings. And I think it's a longer and a less acceptable route. And a bridge to the north of the current one on Manningley Road, I think it's just adding problems rather than solving them.
Okay, thank you for that. Mr. Michael?
I'm very unclear as to where the track is going to go once it gets over the other level. The suggestion is to go back into Manningley Road, then it gets stuck on Northampton Road. It's it. Where's it actually going to, how's it going to get to the city centre?
I'm not sure that it's meant to actually get to the city centre. We're putting things up to try and stop that. But I think the idea is for it to connect up as best as possible where option 3A is trying to go. But also, from what's been discussed, there might be some more positives if you are going across the M11 more north. You're not ending up with everyone in one place. That's the discussion. At the moment, I know there's some people that prefer 3A, I know there's some people that prefer option 4 for the bridge. I'm just trying to find some way forward for voting on this amendment. Councillor Danger, can you help me with that, or is this something different? Because I was going to go back to Councillor Smith.
What I was going to say, Chair, is we are only here recommending the working out of options. We're not discussing where we're going to fall down. There is a lack of information about Route 4. There is a feeling that Route 3 is maybe is a bit too radical. There is a belief that 3A may be credible. We're looking at options, and we don't have sufficient information to look at what option 4, with a little bit of input from elected representatives, might add. And I think that's what we're looking at. How we come down, I don't know if this is the call. We are talking about the options for working up, not the decision about what we would like to recommend being said.
I understand. And also, there's 2 weeks before the ball. And so, what I was going to suggest, Councillor Smith, is that your amendment could actually be a little bit broader, and that we would like to see options 3A and option 4 brackets, with the possibility of a bridge to the north of the existing bridge, close brackets, worked up. That seems to me to encompass everyone's wishes around here at the moment. I can't see anyone that wouldn't vote against it, but you never know. So, are you happy with that? Graham, have you got that?
Yes.
It's a very broad amendment. Anyone else like to speak on this at all before I actually go to a vote? Can you say it again, Councillor
Dick?
Of course. Of course, hopefully. Graham's got it.
So, the wording that we used, and please correct me if you want to make an amendment, so you would like to see 3A and 4 brackets with the possibility of a bridge to the north of the existing bridge, close brackets, workshop.
It's simple and something to take to the board.
Okay.
Councillor Smith.
All right. Are you proposing that the bit about excluding the land beside the open footpath is not included at this point because it actually confuses the matter?
Basically, yes. I am proposing to exclude that at the moment because if it is being worked up, it's something we can come back to at a later date. I think the important thing is trying to encompass what we're trying to achieve and the route that people actually want to take and get them worked up, and then we can look at more detail. That's what I'm trying to do, and that's a recommendation I want to take to the board is where I'm trying to get to. Okay, no one else wishes to speak on that. So on that recommendation, on that amendment, is everyone happy with that? All those in favour, please raise your hands. Eight. All those against? Abstentions? There must be more than you've ever looked at, isn't there?
Assuming you were taking it for granted, but yes, I hope so.
You abstained, okay, thank you. Is that a good one? That's a big one. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, obviously, as always, with taking these to the board, there's been much discussion. The voting is just an indication of the strength of the feeling towards the end of the discussion. So, that was an easy one. Councillor Bridget, next one.
The next one is just for recommendation 3, just refers to Roman numerals 4, page 24, where catchment area 3 is replaced now with catchment area 4. So that just sort of reflects back to the decision you just made.
Sorry, am I reading this wrong? We need to include 3A as well as 4, don't we? Am
so
I reading
3,
this
3A and 3A and 4, so you're replacing, so we've just essentially got rid of option 3. Is that
yes?
So we're replacing.
Well, I'd like to think we have that much power, but it's out of
options. So you're just putting option 4 in there as well, so we're making sure we're consulting residents along option 4. As well as
the
option
3A.
So basically,
what we're doing is replacing the letter, the number 3, not 3A, the letter, the number 3 with 4. That would make sense to me. So again, that's this one. Go on. Yeah, this one's 4A. Yeah. So, does everyone understand? From the previous vote, where we're going with this one now, just replacing 3 with 4 as the two options. So, on 3 and 3A, we're having 3A and 4. That's what we'd like to recommend. All those, I don't think there's any point in discussing that one. All those in favour, please raise your hands. Against? Abstentions? Okay, thank you very much. That's 8-1-3. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you.
Councillor Smith.
Right, now, Bradford one. So this is my recommendation number 1, which refers to Roman numerals 2 on page 23. So, the strategy so far has been for a segregated bus route with an associated cycleway with it. As the guided busway. I would like to propose
propose that for the area between Bourne Airfield and the M11, that we ask officers to work up the option of creating a separate, segregated, high-quality cycleway to run cross-country. So the reason being that it is safer, there aren't certain, don't breathe in so many emissions, cyclists don't suffer from glare from headlights, and it is what people who want to be recreational cyclists want. Recreational cyclists are not going to take their 10-year-olds cycling along the A428 with buses and goodness knows what thundering along beside them. So I'm not saying that this will happen, but I would like an option to be worked up, please, which allows for a cross-country, high-quality super cycleway to run through the villages, and the feedback I've got is that's what the villages would like, and this would serve as a safe commuter route, and it would serve as a recreational cycle route. So the amendment to read, agree in principle that a wholly or partly segregated bus route between Campbell and Cambridge, with the potential for a segregated cross-country super cycleway running close to or through the key villages between Bourne Airfield and the M11, best meets the strategic objectives of the City Deal and the City Deal Agreement, given the wider economic benefits. So I'm aware that cyclists, some cyclists will still choose to cycle, you know, on the road, but that is their choice and that's what you see all the time. But I think this is a marvellous opportunity for us to deliver a segregated cycleway that actually meets the needs of all people.
Okay, thank you. I should say this is a little bit more tricky. Also, I noticed that the park and ride isn't mentioned in your amendment at all. Councillor Dick, did you indicate that you wanted to say something there? Please come in.
Not on the proposal that Councillor
Smith. Well, I understand that the park and ride. Yes, can we park your amendment for the moment, Councillor Smith?
Yes,
no pun intended.
You want me to say something about that? No.
Yeah. Anything.
Okay. I would like to surface amendment 2 on the other sheet of the amendments that the members have. I am very concerned, like I think many members are, about the recommendation to select option 3. Unlike the question of the alignment of the route, the recommendation invites us to make a completely definitive statements about whether we want option 3 as opposed to other options. And I think that the issues that have been raised by Cambridge PDN, and I think that's on behalf of quite a lot of people. In relation to the potential visual impact of the car park on the shoulder of the hill. I think they're very concerned, and I think that we need to pause before we vote on selecting option 3. I think at the very minimum, we should have a proper environmental assessment done as urgently as you want, because I know this will have an impact on the alignment. But I think that we should not be driven into option 3 before we have such an assessment with an illustration of whether realistically mitigation is possible. There I have some doubts about that, but I can also see there are some difficult decisions between the alternatives. So for me, transport-wise, I can see why three is recommended, but I think the environmental costs are very high potentially, and I think we need to satisfy ourselves about those before recommending that. So the recommendation that I have here is to change B in Roman numeral 3 so that it says commission, asking officers to commission an environmental impact assessment of park and rights 3.
bring to the Assembly and Board at the earliest feasible opportunity, and there'd be a realistic view to be taken about potential for mitigation. In the meantime, holding the other options, including Scotland Farm under review, what I mean by under review, is to keep them on the table.
Thank you, Councillor Bick. Which thing is?
I think it's important to understand that when you say environmental impact assessment, we've actually moved here. We will be doing in due course of the FRA a full environmental impact assessment. That is done on a very detailed design scheme. So you literally have to design a whole scheme, you have to drainage, flood risk, full environment, landscaping, planting, etc. We didn't actually design the equipment right site in full with all of that. It's work to do that, and then the environmental impact assessment. That will come with the scheme, but it's not something you go over and do in isolation. That's part of how we scheme to do that assessment.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Vick, can I just ask you a question? Are you generally in favour of location 3 for the park and ride, or are you just concerned of its impact on location 3 and you think that you also think that other locations might be more suitable?
I think that it's very understandable from a transport perspective why option 3 has been recommended. But I think in this particular case, the environmental cost of the option would be very hard. I think that's the learning mind you guys have to do lots of people. The trouble with waiting, with saying we let this go forward as the recommended option, and let the process as described for doing environmental assessment over the next year take place, is that by that stage we can move ourselves to option 3. And I think that this is one of those issues which helps us decide whether we want option 3 or whether we should try and make another option work. Now, I've read the papers as thoroughly as I can. I can see some shortcomings in relation to the other two that are numbered, and also Scotland Farm as well. But I do think that if this, as I suspect, we would really struggle to mitigate it, then we might need to look at those other options. About the effect of car park lighting miles away after dark. And these, to me, are the key impact issues that we need to assess so that members can understand what they would be buying into if they went to option 3. And in my mind, this could be the worst case, but I mean, let officers prove otherwise.
Well, I'd like to go maybe one step further from the chair and actually try and take location 3 out of the equation as much as possible. I don't like location 3, I like location 2, but that's a personal thought of my own. But location 3 does seem to be, for me personally, the wrong place, as you say, from a transport perspective, absolutely ideal. From every other perspective, as far as I can see, absolutely not ideal. So I don't know if you would like to try and incorporate something in an amendment. I don't know, let's open up for discussion. Would we like to have more done on location 3? Would we like more done on locations 1, 2, Scotland Farm, etc., and location 3 at the same time, I guess? But with emphasis on all of them, or not so much emphasis on location 3 because we don't like it. So I've got 3 people that wish to speak on this. Is this on the park and ride screens? Yeah, I've got Mr. Williams, then I've got Councillor Cuffrey, and then I've got Bishop Smith, and then I've got Dave Bailey. Mr. Williams.
So, yeah, on the park and ride specifically, it's interactive. We have a strategy, that's something we're getting in very quickly, and actually, that's probably benefit. So, generally speaking, we favour getting it done as quickly as possible. But I am very concerned about the proposal of the ocean site 3. Just like Councillor Dick, I went through 170 papers, and I could see roughly why Scotland Farm was a less preferred option, and I could understand those. But I couldn't find anywhere where there was a side-by-side comparison, saying what the pros and cons were. And really, I kept going through something, it must be there somewhere, but I just don't see it. So I'd rather not exclude option 3, being a scientist for that to get a more basis. But I'd like to see a nice side-by-side comparison of one, two, and three, and see what the pros and cons are. You know, it may be that site three is best from a bus perspective. What about passenger cars arriving in the imagining car? So it matters to see what those different options are before we make quite what sounds, from Robin's comments, quite a disastrous environmental decision. And as you can see it in the documentation. So I was originally, I was sort of with Councillor Dick's point, but I think you're going down a road of a year trying to analyse it. Let's go forward, on a side-by-side comparison, and what compromises might you be prepared to take to maintain the quality of that area?
You put it much better than I did, thank you.
Are you prepared to support that request, Mike?
Okay, thank you. Councillor Carpen.
For me, personally, I'm not at all keen on option three because of the environmental impact of it. And also, being on a South Cairns councillor, you can't say my own reasons for not pushing to have number three. I would prefer to pursue two and one because it has of the impact, the lack of impact on the environment. Plus, as Councillor Dickinson rightly said, there is a lighting issue and there's a lot of other implications in there. So from my personal perspective, I would like to see food taking out of the equation.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Smith.
Thank you. We've had so many people, knowledgeable people, speak against option three. I think we can't ignore that. I think we should park it, to use your pun. Certainly work up option two. I don't have an opinion on option one, certainly work up option two. I think there has to be a very good reason why nowhere else is suitable for us to go with option three. So certainly option two seems to win. I can find nothing in the papers that says as you to actually say option three is any better. Makes me wonder, you know, why that decision is made. So I wouldn't want to see any more money spent on option three at the moment. I think if we should stop and we should do the work on option two.
Thank you, Councillor Page.
Thank you, Chair. I'm going to put in three for sustainability. When this works properly, when the buses are flowing up and down this road, and when the thousands and thousands of people are coming in from that side of Cambridge, then I would like to ask how sustainable are the carpet sizes. The Scotland Farms to me seems to present an option that is unlimited, that could grow like Topsy as and when it was required to supply, to take all of the cars off the roads and supply the buses. So I see no reason for maintaining option three in the plan. I hear the arguments about how unpleasant it will be to look at, and I think that we should really think to work out Scotland Farm because it's sustainable. It can grow and it can take more and more cars. Because there will come a time when the park and rides that we've built will not be big enough, hopefully. And at that time, this one will grow and the others come.
Thank you, Councillor Cameron and Councillor Lee.
Yes, I'm just looking closely at the Corbett survey. I love having these when I go cycling. But it's just a clearly obvious thing that there's so much space around Scotland Park for any future development of the park and ride beyond its initial creation. And I think we're also at a point here that we've got to listen to the local people who come forward from Coton and have spoken very strongly about wanting to maintain their environment. And I can see there is this clear alternative to option 3A there. This park and ride would even be, how should I say, it would be in a position on Scotland Farm where it's going to be a shorter drive for the motorists coming from the west anyway. They pull into the park and ride. What's that, a mile or so? Mm-hmm. Close, away from Cambridge, so there's less of a drive. There's less of a chance of actually backing up. So that's why I'm very much in favour of Scotland Farms.
And also, are we going to want to talk about this wonderful suggestion to have the site?
Yes, it's been a part and not forgotten.
Right.
Councillor Lee.
Well, lots to be said about Scotland Farm. I think it's right, it should be added to the mix and looked at along with the other sites. One thing that hasn't been said about Scotland Farm is that it too is at the crest of a ridge, and so it would be visible from a long way away by different people, admittedly, but that too needs to be taken into consideration. It's very obvious why option 3 is included in the mix, because it is unquestionably the best of the sites in transport terms. But, as has been pointed out by Mr. Field and others, it does have environmental challenges. And that is why we are asking the experts in this field to see what mitigation measures can be incorporated. You know, will the light aspect be ameliorated if you have low level light rather than the high lamp standards that we have at other carbon red sites, for instance? Is there planting that could screen the site so that it's invisible or much less visible from further afield? I don't know the answer to either of those, but I do think that we will benefit from an assessment of what measures could be incorporated and what effect they would have, so that we're not basing this just on a sort of gut feeling that perhaps it's not the right place, but to take into account that it does have transport advantages, even if there may be environmental considerations that too need to be taken into account and ameliorated.
Okay, thank you. I think there is a consensus on this, in so much as there's concern and unhappiness about option 3. But also, if we're going to do our job properly, we'd like to see a comparison of all the post carbon line and Scotland Farm. And I think Mr. Williams put it very well, that it would be good to see a side-by-side table of pros and cons for all three post sites plus Scotland Farm. Mr. Williams, come in, please.
Okay, and we've got quite a short time limit, it's maybe 6 or 9 months. And how much of the data is there? What we haven't been able to do is just look at it in a way that we can understand.
Officers, how soon can we have that?
It depends on the extent of let's say the second person. We do have draft technical law 1 in here that set out that higher comparison between the different sites. I'm sensing that we're really meeting as it were here. And from our perspective, we don't think either Scotland Farm or Site 1 work at all well in transport terms. Because of where they are intersecting traffic, and they're intersecting traffic at the point where the condition starts to suck you off and your carriage.
But I understand, and I don't want the officers to use us for the numbers of the comparison.
Such compromises that we take both sites 2 and 3 forward to the next stage, we can do that environmental appraisal rather than impact assessment. And in terms of that, so it's a point. So, in case, could we mitigate things? We have rights to mitigate these impacts as much as we possibly can in the design scheme with all the lighting, etc. So,
I understand the question is, how have you got the information for sites 1, 2, and 3, or sorry, locations 1, 2, and 3, and Scotland Farm? And if not, is it possible? And if it's possible, how long it will take?
We would suggest it takes. We could take our sites through to the next stage of environmental proposal, which is not a full environmental impact assessment, and that would be good. But we accommodate that, I think, within the existing work alongside the risk assessment work.
So it will sound as you know the words. So I can't understand what you're actually saying.
We would, the next stage of work, if you look at the routes, is to gather together all the environmental information that's currently available. And all that information, and to come forward with the procedure group options in the spring of next year. We could combine that with looking forward at the park and ride sites to a similar level, not a full environmental impact assessment, not a full detail of design. I believe at the same time today we'll have to go back and look at resources and consult resources to do that.
Okay, but that would allow us, if yours officers are right, and Scotland Farm is a no-go, and location 1's a no-go, then we now get down to 2 and 3. But let's us decide, along with the board, what we'd like to do on that. I think that's what we're saying here at the Assembly. So thank you for that. So, Assembly members, suggesting here is that whenever a park and ride location specific is mentioned, that we obviously take that out, and we generally say to the board that we are not happy with a site-specific park and ride at the moment, and we'd like a comparison of locations 1, 2, and 3 with the addition of Scotland Farm, and the officers have said that they can work that alongside and in parallel to the actual route work that they're doing as well. Does everyone understand that?
Yes.
Okay. Can I hold those in agreement? Please raise your hands. Unanimous. I'm going to find Park Bridget Smith.
The only thing I want to add is that there's obviously been lots of public relations challenges to the city deal. There's been successes as well, and the Chisholm Trail is an enormous success. So this is an opportunity to kind of replicate the success of the Chisholm Trail by, you know, putting a segregated high quality cycleway separate from the segregated bus route through the villages that suffer the bad stuff from the busway, and actually hopefully give them something good back. So I would just like the option worked up by officers, please, exactly as per written on the paper.
Okay, now can you indulge me and remind me what is you actually asking, and then I'll ask for a second and then we'll have a discussion and debate on it. So
do you want to read this again?
Okay, it's almost like starting again, I apologise,
no,
but
that's
good to refresh a sort of thing.
Yeah, it's been a long day. Agree in principle that a wholly or partly segregated bus route between Campbell and Cambridge, with the potential for a segregated cross-country super cycleway running close to or through the key villages between Bourne Airfield and the M11, best meets the strategic objectives of the city deal and the city deal agreement, given the wider economic benefits.
Okay, so this is in place of page 23, recommendations 3, Roman numeral 2, and we have taken out the reference to Park and Ride for these reasons, which was done before. Bit of luck. Would you have a second on that? Thank you, Councillor. Well, okay, well, that's good to have 3 seconders. That's a good start. So, we'll have Councillor Lee seconding that. He was just first. Who would like to speak?
Can I just answer you? Sorry, just pick up a very specific point.
Please do.
Not to underestimate the challenges of superhighway cycling scheme. We are looking at lots of cycling schemes, but a separate study, but underestimate just how different the conflict
is. I assume it would start off quite high level, and then we would dig down into the detail. So I understand your concern and reservations. Okay. I've got Councillor Cuffley, and then Sir Michael Marsh.
Thank you, Chair. I have to say I think it's a great proposal, a great amendment. I think it's given us a great opportunity to look at encouraging cycling as well. The aspect of it is there's a huge amount of common sense in here. Why would you want bikes going next to a bus? You're obsessing on waiting to happen, you know, from my perspective. And I agree with what Councillor Swift said, that that it will encourage families out there, it will encourage people to use it, it's much safer, it's much cleaner, and I have my full support, I have to say.
Okay, thank you, Sir Mike.
Yes, I worry about your cycle where you're in like 2 villages, you're going to knock a few villages down from the airport.
They have full cars, at least. They have existing.
Thank you for that. Cancellation.
Thank you, Chair. Only briefly asking, are we talking about in addition to a cycleway that follows the main route? And then what is the cost implementation of building something entirely separate? Right? I think the idea is great. It might be a tranche 2 thing, not a tranche 1. I'm really in favour of it, it sounds fantastic, but I just think, what is the cost implication?
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, basically we've got 2 weeks between now and the board. I'm sure officers will be asked the same question at the board, and then they can decide if they want it worked out or not. This is only recommendations from us, and as you say, it looks like a good recommendation. I've got Councillor Leake and Councillor Kavanagh. Councillor Smith, is it really, really urgent?
It was just to say that, you know, if there's any arguments against the kind of narrow bit of red on the grounds of lack of width, that actually mitigates for that as well. So, you know, hopefully, you know, that the route running closer to the 428 will be much easier for not having the requirement for high class cycling facilities, because we've actually moved that down into the
quite headcounts, isn't it? Councillor
Cadman. Oh. Yeah, I am conscious of the other plans, the other schemes for urban, the provision will be labelled greenways, which the site project team have been devising, and which are very welcome. And what I've become aware of, you know, in my role as cycling chaplain for Cambridgeshire, is that there is huge suppressed demand out beyond the boundaries of Cambridge, in the surrounding villages. And anyone who actually goes cycling in the village, around the villages of Cambridgeshire, on the existing roads will notice, you know, the speed of the traffic on those roads. I mean, there are people out there who just are not aware of speed limits in their vehicles and so on. So what should be a very pleasurable experience going out on your bicycle on a sunny Sunday afternoon with your family can turn into quite a frightening experience of cars speeding all over the place. So what I think would be a great enhancer for people's health and general life experience in our county will be to have a comprehensive network of cycleways. The greenways is a start. Now this suggestion is a fantastic extra suggestion, because it will link all the villages between Cambridge and Cambridge. And it's not just for people going all the way from Cambridge to Cambridge, it's actually linking people in the surrounding village. So you also got to bear in mind, it costs a lot less to build a cycleway than it does to build roadways, highways. And so I fully endorse this, and let's keep it off the agenda, not let it slip into phase two or phase three or even.
Okay, thank you. I've got Colonel Valentine, Councillor Lee. Colonel Valentine.
I'm a cyclist and a cycling enthusiast, but we're all talking about sunny afternoons with our family, and that's not the purpose of that. That is this deal, which is about economic prosperity. So, as I understand it, alongside this segregated busway would be a segregated cycle path, and I'm not sure at the moment I would support the building of another segregated cycle path, which is mainly for happy families on a Sunday afternoon. And I'm just
going
to see how
it can be to see
our criteria for
the city. I think it's instead of, so don't mind, but I understand it not. Thank you. Mr. Means, I'll bring you in here for our
next Councillor Lee. If I make sure, Councillor Carpen has already alluded to the proposals, which aren't really surfaced yet, but we are looking at a new network of cycles reaching out to the villages beyond Cambridge. One of the rules of article on the cycle superhighways. That may get a bit controversial when we start as purely to converting rural right-of-ways to cycleways, but the Carpen path has been suggested as a potential route. I'm quite happy with that. What I would have to say is, in terms of not having a cycle path next to the bus stop, if it's a segregation route, we would need emergency access, so we would need a route on site, so that would effectively become a cycleway. What we found with the bus route, when we were surfacing that route, cyclists were cycling on the highway itself. So they will cycle on it whether you build a route or not. When it comes to the proposal, which we said we will evaluate from the LLF, that is for a minimal width of carriageway on the inclined drive, and we propose 7 metres, which is actually below standard, and the bus route. If you
do that as an oversight process to build it, then you're fully safe to build it. And I could not recommend that as a safe scenario. So, fully support segregation routes, direct, all that at all, because it's concerned about where we're developing and doing this proposal. But our recommendation would be you do need that site route next to the bus route as you have, for instance.
Thank you. I'm sure that will expand to the board as well. I think it's the principle here rather than the details, but thank you for that. Councillor Lee.
I think the other speakers are quite right, that it is going to be a very pleasant route to cycle along. But I'd like, if I may, to disagree with Helen Ballantyne and say that the justification for doing this is not because it's going to be a nice thing for the people who want sunny Sunday afternoon. It is part of the kernel of what the city is trying to achieve, which is local shift. And with the best will in the world, a cycle route next to next to a busway and potentially next to a busy road as well is not as attractive as one that is out in the open countryside, particularly if it's maintained to a high standard. And we do know that people in Cambridgeshire are willing to cycle surprisingly long distances to get to usually their place of work. If the standard of the provisions, therefore, is there. So I think the justification for it is what the main use is going to be for people who do use it to travel into work, even on those wet and windy days when cycling is such a challenge. But it will also be enjoyed by other people, and rightly so. If you build it, they will come.
Okay, quite well in the middle there. Councillor Smith, you did say you wanted to come back on that, was it?
Yes,
no, it's fine. Okay. I was just reading your amendment, and actually it says, agreeing in principle that a wholly or partly segregated bus route between Camden and Cambridge, with the potential for a segregated cross country super cycleway running close to or through the key villages, etc., etc. So, what we're saying here is to have a high level look and see the possibility of the potential. Does that make sense?
I think so.
Yes.
I think so.
It's not saying go away and definitely do it. It's to have a look at it.
Yeah.
Okay. Councillor Bick.
Can I just have some clarification? Because I like the idea of this and I'm inclined to support it, but I do think it would be. I need to know that we aren't saying this should be instead of a cycleway by the side of the busway. Because it seems to me that the sort of concept that we've been proposing with this cycleway is going to be some distance away, some considerable distance away from where the busway might be. And so there will be a need for cyclists from places closer to the busway than to this other route. And as officers have said, we should make sure that cyclists are properly catered for the route that they're nearest to. Otherwise, we sort of increase safety on one side and increase danger on the other side. And I'm in favour of a net improvement rather than just balancing out.
I understand what you're saying. The amendment does infer that it will be instead of, because it says the potential for a segregated cross-country super cycleway from the bus route. So, Councillor Smith, what was your vision on this one? Can I ask, just stay there quickly.
Okay. My vision was that it would be instead of, because it's the safer, healthier, more pleasant option. So you're cycling safely, you can cycle with young children, you're not breathing in all the fumes, you're not being dazzled by headlights. So that was my original intention. And I'm interested in what I've been told about, and I know it was confirmed as well, about the access for a busway being required. But then this isn't going to be a guided busway, is it? It's going to be something different. So I think we just need to keep all the options open because, you know, money is tight here, and I can't imagine that I will get through, you know, that we build, you know, what was originally planned and another cross-country cycleway as well. You know, it is about driver ownership. And the other thing I didn't mention was, you know, I've been banging on this as we've been in these meetings about good park and cycle. So, you know, and the opportunity with the new park and ride rovers is that you leave your car there and then you easily link onto a cross
cycle route, so you could then cycle in as well, so you know, that adds more to it there. So I suppose it will come down to economics. So I suppose we need to know what the figures are, whether a reduced cycleway could go along the busway with, you know, the good one being the cross-country one. That might be an option, but you know, I think we need to look at it in its entirety and see what is reasonable. It seems silly to build it twice.
Thank you. I think there's general feeling that's a good idea and it should be looked at. But I think with Councillor Pitt and with Helen Valentine, you know, we need to be clear as to whether this is instead of, as well as, etc. And I don't think we're clear at the moment, but between now and it going to the board and being presented to the board, I think officers can look at this and actually inform the board. If we put something like the recommendation that you've got, they can inform the board as to the feasibility, without a study, but the feasibility of where it could or couldn't work. I think that would be a sensible idea. At the moment, the default position is a cycleway runs alongside the bus.
The idea
of it being instead and second phases, etc., can be looked at. So I think that's fair, and it's something that we're going to ask the board, and obviously officers will have their answers when it goes to the board. So I'm happy with that. Okay, thank you. So what I'll do is I'll ask all those in favour of putting that to the board as an idea, please raise your hands. Against? Abstain? Two. Okay. Thank you very much, everyone. Okay. Councillor Smith, you've got some additional recommendations, but they're not really in the remit of the city deal as such. Do you want to just mention for a minute?
Okay. So, mention has been made already today that, you know, people living in Campbell don't all come to Cambridge, you know, and more and more of them, because of escalating house prices in London, are going to be going to the main line station in St. Neots. And currently, you can't get a bus from Campbell to the main line station in St. Neots. So, I would just like us to make a commitment to do our best to ensure that the final proposals the cycleway continues from Campbell and West to St. Neots mainline station, and secondly, that any buses running on the new busway continue on from Campbell to St. Neots mainline station. Because as it is, you know, people getting out of their cars, and often getting out of their cars generally, regardless of whether they're coming east or whether they're coming west. So I know it's outside our remit, but I, you know, we are influential, and I think we should, when we're talking to bus companies about the services, it should be important to us that the buses go onto the mainline station. And you know, when we're talking to our partners about the cycleway, be it along the busway, be it something separate through the countryside, we should be talking about our partners about that continuing on to St. Neots mainline station.
Thank you very much. Right. I'm going to bring this to a conclusion because we have spent nearly 2.5 hours on it. Right, sir.
Chair, I'm
okay. Yeah, I wasn't sure whether you were going to come in or not, but please do.
Okay, so this is, I think, completely central to the agenda item in terms of bus stop. The issue of improving bus access to the city centre is that the city centre doesn't have the means yet of assimilating that increased number of buses. And one of the things that we need to do is to have in place a proper bus management strategy for what happens to the other side, the city end of the busway. And connected with that, because we are hoping that not everyone who wants to go in the general direction of Cambridge goes through the city centre anyway, we want to make sure that the people coming in towards the city from the west can split off to their destinations at the earliest possible point. And to do that,
as close in time to the time we do this scheme that we put on the table here. So the amendment that I'm proposing, amendment 3 on the sheet, which requests officers to ensure that designs for the Western Orbital bus route, which is the one that will take the splitting of bus traffic down towards the biomedical campus, the bus route through northwest Cambridge to the science park, which goes through northwest Cambridge, Darwin Green when it's built, and the management of buses in the city centre, all fully integrate with this project. And it's a steer to the opposite. I hope it's underlining something that everyone wants anyway. But this busway is going to be as effective in the end as it can deliver traffic to the northwest and to the southwest as it is to the city centre. And going with that, to seek that those schemes to the northwest, the southwest, and the management of buses within the city, what comes out of that integration is delivered as close as possible in time to the eastern section of this busway project. Now, those are relative concepts. We're talking about seeking as close as possible, but I do think there needs to be some sense in which there is a steer given here, that this is a scheme that needs to fit together with others. And if it's too long on the ground without those others, then we're going to be delivering negative results. So I hope this is non-controversial, and I hope we can get that kind of steer from this amendment.
Councillor Dickey, to me it's not controversial, but where will it fit into our recommendations that we're being looked at? So exactly where?
I was proposing to insert it as recommendations to request officers as a section.
So you're on page 24?
Between the current 3 and 4. Between the current new and 3 and 4.
Right, okay, so.
The freestanding is a freestanding recommendation.
Say again. I see, yes, I didn't see your diligent renumbering of Roman numerals down the bottom. Okay, just to confuse things, just to shift everything down a little bit more. Okay, to me this makes sense. Does anyone want to speak against this at all? Come join us, Mr. Mees.
What I do is this. I like to think this is what we're already doing. So, for example, in the modelling of the bus service, we've assumed third of the buses go round to Northwest Cambridge to the Science Park already. And so
no problem.
Absolutely no problem with this whatsoever. And that's it. Is that what we're doing?
It's meant to be a steer, and I think everyone's in agreement. So, yeah, that's agreed.
I'm not surprised if we agree.
We agree.
Can I go to the next one?
Please, next one.
And I think actually this is redoubled, Amendment 4 on the same sheet. The importance of this one is redoubled given all of the conversation we've had about all other aspects of this so far today. Amendment 4 inserts into the section that has now become Roman numeral 5 a new letter between B and C, which asks that the result of A and B above, which is taking forward these plans and going out to consultation with them, doesn't happen before it's been brought back to the Assembly and the Board. Now, when I wrote the amendment down, I was thinking that that was because there was still quite a lot of variability in this, a lot of loose ends, that I think members would meet this again. Before it actually goes and we know and are satisfied we can stand behind what goes out of public consultation. In the meeting so far, we've added more questions into that mix, and I think it makes it even more valid that this does come back to us before it goes out of public consultation again.
Okay, thank you. Again, it makes sense to me. Does anyone have any problem with that? I mean, I've got a problem with the numbering going forward, but I'm going to do my best on that. In fact, I'm going to let Graham do his best on that. But does anyone have anything to say against that? No, in that case, as far as I'm... Ah, is that against?
Sorry, just in terms of clarifying what's been getting, decision stage, it's formal decision stages, and a series of actual groups, actual lines in front of you with all the environmental information, all the pros and cons, including the views of the public. So, in terms of what I would say to you, we could put that information in front of you, we would be saying to you, don't take a decision on those routes until you've got the views of the public. So essentially, we've got to sample that information for a way into the public domain. Now, that's fine, that's what we want to do, just to be clear on decision making.
Mr. Wayne?
You thought it was a nice chance to say it. I think, just using the park and ride as an example, if we look at side by side comparisons and rule out the worst option before we go for the consultation, we just save ourselves 6 months of awful publicity. If it turns out option three is the best option, then we'll start to accept the awful publicity. But if we get a chance to avoid it, we should take it.
Okay, thank you. Tanya's gagging to get in here.
Probably just worth flagging that. There may be a need to push back the time scales that are set out in the papers in terms of the overall project management if the board were to accept the recommendation, should the Assembly choose to make that recommendation, that this needs to come back through the Assembly board, which I think would in practice be in June, wouldn't it? So that would mean later consultation and a later spatial decision.
I hear those comments for officers, but I think for members it's important that we get this right. And when we go and ask our public, we're asking you questions that we believe are right ones rather than wrong ones. As it stands at the moment, despite the fact that we asked for a deep analysis to see the park and life sites, that we've thrown in two quite different alignments for the route. I think we need to see that back again before we send something out to the public. And I recognise that it may delay this a little bit in time, but I don't think it's good enough that we just crack all this away and wait to hear what you told the public in a year's time. I think there is a requirement for the sensitivity of all this, that the members are a lot more involved in than that and have another chance to see what you want to take from us as well.
I agree, Councillor. I'd much rather do this properly. Thank you. I didn't have anyone that wishes to speak against it from the Assembly, so now's your chance. Otherwise, I'm going to say that we are in agreement. Okay? I'm seeing nods, so that's agreed as well. Thank you, Councillor. Is that yourself done?
I'm done.
Thank you. Give you 1 minute while I just confer with Grant, because I need to try and get recommendations on it. So, what we have. Recommendations in front of us, three, round 1, 2, 3, and then we've got B, and then we've got round 4, and then we've got A and B, and then A, B, C, D. So these are all recommendations, and I'm going to do my best just to clarify. We know we've got it right in the minutes and how we written it down, so bear with us, but when we look at page 23, recommendations, 3, Roman numeral 1. I think we can all agree with that. I think we've got a big tick by that. Roman numeral 2 is, which is amendment, which we have agreed to. Is that okay with everyone? Roman numeral 3, Graham, can you, have you got that?
So this was in relation to Kenzie's and
what we've done is we've taken park and ride, any section of park and ride out of it altogether. And so what we did with 3, yes, was is that your first one? Just 1 second, members, apologies.
So councillors need to
3B. Okay, and then obviously going over the page on to 24, B is now looking at partner life sites, location 172 of Scotland Farm, and a comparison table, etc. And then we've got four
that's become five. We've got a new four.
So we've got a new four from Councillor Dick, and then the fours that are on your page become five, but when it says areas 3A and 3, they become areas 3A and 4. And then when you go down to the responsibility 2 and A, it's got catchment area 3A and then brackets. We take out the brackets and we just make catchment area 3A and 4. We take out B because it's a specific location for part of mine, and we've already dealt with that. C also is taken out because we need to come back to that. And I'm just looking at D, I think D might be able to stand. Mr. Williams.
I was just going to clarify on catchment area 3 and 4, but also assuming that the bridge to the north of.
Thank you. Yes, absolutely right. In brackets, including the possibility of a bridge, yes, close brackets. Thank you for that. Members, I think there's going to be an element of trust here because it has been very hard to put all this together. I think we know what we're talking about. I know we know what we're talking about. We'll get it out to everyone as much as possible. We all know what we've agreed on and what we've discussed. It was a huge, huge item to discuss, and there's been lots of amendments and lots of discussion. And I thank you, officers, for your patience with us as well. So I'm going to take this on the block and basically say, is everyone happy with what is going to the board's recommendations from this assembly? All those in favour, please raise your hands. Well, that's unanimous. So I think that's going to be a result for today. So thank you very much, everyone.